You know, there is a dangerous version of Christianity that does not accept suffering. It rejects it. Although I understand why people might start at that position, because the end result is the full perfection of the people of God one day. But that is such a dangerous understanding of the Christian gospel, because these very things that we are asking God to get rid of are often the very things that are His instruments for molding us.
When Jesus became a man, he became a real human being with all of life's battles and pain. The Jesus You Never Noticed, an 8-part series from Charles Price, shows how Christ's life reflects our own struggles. Discover the real Jesus, the Jesus You Never Noticed. Today's message is called, He Was a Root Out of a Dry Ground.
I'm going to read a few verses to you in a moment from Isaiah chapter 53, but before I read them, I want to explain what I'm going to talk about this morning and over a number of weeks from now on in. I want to talk about what I'm calling as a title, The Jesus You Have Never Noticed. The text for this whole series is in Hebrews chapter 5, and I'm going to read from verse 7 to 9, but I will come to Isaiah 53 in a few minutes. Hebrews 5, verse 7 to 9, the writer writes this: during the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Now, the section of those verses that is the springboard, if you like, for these studies over these next few weeks, is that Jesus offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears. He learned obedience from what he suffered. We don't know all the details of his cries and his tears and his suffering, because there's much in the life of Jesus that we have no detail about. In fact, if you took all four Gospels, which record the history of Jesus as a man, it gives us the historical record of his life. If you put all the events in those four Gospels together, we have about 1 month's worth of information. Now, Jesus ministered for about 3 years, so if it was just about his 3 years of ministry, there's 35 months about which we know nothing. 1 month is the content of those four Gospels. But actually, we know from John's Gospel that if everything that could be written was written, said John, the whole world would not contain the books that would have to be written. So there was a lot more that went on. But the details of that we know nothing about, or we know very little about. But we do know that during those 33 or so years of his life, there were cries, there were tears, there was suffering, and these were means by which he learned obedience. Under the surface of our visible outer lives are deep inner workings that are invisible to most other people around us. I have a picture here of an iceberg. And because of the relative density of ice and seawater, there is approximately 1/9 of the iceberg that is above the surface, and 8/9 of it float below the surface. And this is a true principle in your life and my life as well, that the things that people see, the things that are obvious about us and evident about us, are only the tip of a whole lot of things that are going on under the surface of our lives. It was also true of Jesus. And underneath the surface that's not visible is our history, our environment, our struggles, our battles, our fears, our sufferings. Some of those things might be good, some of those things might be bad, but in the course of time, those things going on under the surface will work their way out in the outer surface of our lives. When I was in Australia earlier this month, I took a walk with someone one day in a rainforest, and they have some of the tallest trees in the world, these eucalyptus trees that go up to 60 meters in height, about 200 feet. But they equally have roots that go, in some cases, as deep. In this picture, the roots go as far down as the tree goes up, and they go even further out in width. There are depths and widths under the surface of all of our lives that other people don't see. They will see the result of that. And there is a private life underneath the surfaces that mold us and make us. Some of those things seem out of control. Some of those things seem under control. Some are difficult. Some are painful. If we could, most of us would rewrite the script of our lives if we could. And Jesus was not exempt from these forces and these influences and events in his life, whereby through suffering in particular, says the writer of Hebrews, he learned obedience. When Jesus became a man, he became a real man, not a superman. He wasn't given an easy track through life. You know, when you go to the airport, they ask you to come 1, 2, or 3 hours in advance, depending how far you're traveling, because you spend about 1 hour of that time often in the security line where you're lining up to go through checking of your baggage and possessions, and your whole body gets x-rayed too in some occasions. But you might have noticed that there are some people who have a card that permits them to go down the fast lane. And they kind of come in and go down this lane, pass everybody else, and there's about two people at the end of the lane, and they're into the security area and out the other side within just a few minutes. And we stand in the long line wishing I could have a card like that. Well, Jesus didn't have a fast lane card. He lined up with the rest of us as far as the human experience is concerned, subject in all points like we to temptation, to attack, to difficulties, and to hardships. Our danger is we tend to put Jesus on a pedestal and detach him from the real world of struggles and temptations and battles. We often depict him. You know, if you see a picture of him in a long white gown, and of course it's perfectly clean, there's no dirt on it, no soil marks or anything like that. Jesus had dirty feet, metaphorically as well as literally. He lived in an environment that included cries, tears, and suffering. And I want to look with you at what we know about this journey in Jesus' life, because I believe it will encourage us and challenge us and help us. We have little information, of course, about the formative years of Jesus' life. We call the first 30 years the silent years. We have his birth events. And there is a general statement made of his growing years in Luke 2, verse 52, where it says, Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. That's an extremely well-balanced growth. He grew intellectually in wisdom. He grew physically in stature. He grew spiritually in favor with God. He grew socially in favor with men. But notice, none of this was automatic. He grew in these areas. Jesus Christ was not God pretending to be a human being. He became, and there's mystery here, of course, but he became a real human being where he had to learn and he had to grow. He didn't have wisdom downloaded from heaven intact, knowledge downloaded fully intact. He wasn't lying in the manger in Bethlehem, pretending to be a baby, saying any minute now there'll be some wise men coming through that door. No, he lived like a baby because he was a baby, dependent on his mother, like every baby. This is the remarkable thing about the incarnation. He became as we are and was not exempt other than the fact he did not have a sinful nature that we have, and therefore he was sinless. But he was subject to all the pressures and hardships and difficulties that makes life for most of us. We have one boyhood event when he was the age of 12. when his parents took him up to Jerusalem at the temple, and they began the journey home and then realized he wasn't with them. He'd stayed back, and he was talking to the scribes and the teachers. And it says, everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. So we know by then he had some education. We know by then that he was able to read. And here's a mystery. The one who was involved in the inspiration of Scripture as God had to learn to read as a boy. There's mystery there, of course. But the reason why I want to read to you from Isaiah 53 this morning is because this is one of the most remarkable prophetic chapters in the Old Testament, talking about Jesus, the Messiah. And we're very familiar with the middle section that talks about his crucifixion with remarkable detail more than 700 years before crucifixion was even being practiced by the Romans. For instance, in verse 5 and 6, if I read that to you, I'm reading this to show you that we understand these verses perfectly well, where it says, he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities, the punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We are all like sheep, we've gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And we read that, we understand it. There is the depiction of Jesus as our substitute, repeatedly, he for us. You'll find that in there. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. By his wounds, we are healed. It's he, us. It is Christ as our substitute, satisfying the justice of God. Now, how do we know that? Because we have in the gospel records a description of his crucifixion. We have in the epistles the doctrine of the cross, why it is that Jesus Christ died, and how it is that he satisfied the justice of God. So we don't have any mystery about those verses because the New Testament corresponds to them in explaining to us what happened to Jesus at his crucifixion. But the early parts of this chapter, we can run over very quickly because we don't have corresponding New Testament records to explain exactly how this works out. But it is an important source of information to us. Let's read them together. Isaiah 53, verse 1 to 3. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Then he goes on to describe what we know fully to be the crucifixion and substitutionary atonement of Christ. But in these opening verses, I want to point out three things that he tells us about Jesus. First of all, let me talk about his personal environment. It says there in verse 2 that he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. Now get that image. A root out of dry ground, a tender shoot in a hostile environment. When I lived in Zimbabwe for a little over 2 years, many years ago, we usually had about 4 months of rain from October, November, December, January, begin to dry up in February. And then we'd have almost 8 months of no rain at all. And from the moment the sun came up, clear, cloudless blue skies, and that went on months after months. And at the end of the rainy season, the vegetation was rich and green, and you watched it slowly become brown, and then it would become yellow, and then it would become gray, and you never sowed seed in the dry season because it would wither and die. Now, the picture that's given us here of Jesus is that in the dry season, in the dry ground, in the hostile environment, he was like a root that was growing in a dry environment. A root that had put its tentacles right down into searching for water. I have a beautiful picture here, which Hillary took in India, in Calcutta, and it's a tree growing on a roof. I don't know whether a bird dropped a seed there on one occasion, and it germinated, and the roots went looking for moisture. And they've gone down the side of this roof and down the wall and found not only some moisture to sustain it, but to produce a tree growing out of the top of this roof. That is the kind of picture being given to us of Jesus. Just look at his environment for a moment. He was born into a hostile environment on almost every level you can think about. He was conceived in the womb of an unwed mother. And there's a stigma to that, especially in a day when marriage was very clearly ordered. There was a time of betrothal when a man and a woman were legally committed to each other, but they did not live as man and wife. The relationship was not consummated until the wedding later, and it was during that betrothal period that the Holy Spirit brought about the conception of Jesus in the womb of Mary. Joseph thought she'd been unfaithful. Thought he'd put her away quietly because he was a just man. And an angel had to say to him, no, this is of the Holy Spirit. But you know, the angel who told Joseph that didn't tell the neighbors that. And 30 years later, when Jesus is in a debate with the Jews, they say to him, we are not illegitimate children. The implication being, like you are. Because this factor has followed you for 30 years, and the rumors have come down from Nazareth. You were born out of wedlock. There might even be one or two here this morning, and your whole history of your birth has not been a healthy one and a wholesome one. Jesus knew that environment. He was born in a stable, and we talk about that every year at Christmas. We know all about that, laying in a manger. But you think about that. That's a cattle trough. That's where you feed the cattle. That's what a manger is. Not only imagine the unhygienic environment, but why is he being born out in the cattle shed in the first place? Because nobody accepted or had room for his mother and Joseph. As a baby, he became a refugee, fleeing to Egypt with his parents from the tyrant Herod, who was out to destroy all the baby boys in Bethlehem. And so he knew what it was to live in an alien environment as a refugee. Some of you here this morning know what that's like, because you're here, because you fled a hostile environment back at home. He went to live in an insignificant town, Nazareth. And when Nathanael was told in John chapter 1, you know, come and see the Messiah, he's Jesus of Nazareth, his response was, Nazareth? Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? That is a dump. That's not where you expect somebody of significance to come from. And why didn't Jesus grow up in Jerusalem, where he could rub shoulders with all the influential people of the day? Why out in this outback, up in the north? When he preached his first sermon at the age of 30, the crowd at first were impressed. They didn't know he could talk like this. They were impressed, and they listened to what he said. They got angry, and they actually dragged him out of the synagogue, tried to throw him over a cliff, but he walked through them, and he left Nazareth only, as far as we know, ever once went back to the town in which he'd grown up in the next years. They rejected him. But that raises the question, why did they miss him? Why in 30 years weren't the local people at least a little bit enamored? You know, this guy is different. Nobody seemed to say that. You'd have thought by the age of 30, when he got up and began to speak, some would say, oh, you know, I knew there was something different about him. Why didn't he stand head and shoulders above the rest of them? Why, in fact, did they look at him and say, you can't possibly be who you say that you are? Well, let me take you to my second point, which is in the next verse, his physical appearance. It says there in verse 2, second part of verse 2, he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. Do you know what that means? Well, let me suggest something original. I suggest it means what it says. He had no beauty. He was not attractive. Nothing in his appearance would make us desire him. As one commentator says, to be frank, he was ugly. Physically. You know, most artists' impressions of Jesus make him too good looking. When they're casting for Jesus in a film, the stereotypical image they're looking for is somebody strong, good looking, but there is no evidence of that in Scripture. In fact, the reverse. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. Why do the people not recognize him? Because physically, there was nothing attractive. They'd never looked twice at him. You know, if Jesus came in his physical body to this church, if we were to announce this week, he would be sitting here next Sunday morning, and we came eagerly, where is he? I suspect none of us would get him right. We'd be looking for the alpha male, you know, sitting around with the striking eyes and the piercing look and the but actually he'd have no beauty, nothing to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that would make us say, wow. For Jesus to be the perfect man as he was has nothing to do with his physical appearance. It had to do with his moral character. The virtues of Jesus were not physical, but moral. He was loving and kind and just and tender and gentle. Physical appearance has become a huge value in our world. Maybe it always has been, but it certainly is today. One commentator says this, there was nothing in his personal appearance that corresponded to the expectations that had been formed of him. Nothing that should lead them to desire him as their expected deliverer, but everything that would induce them to reject him. At school, when we had to split up into sports teams, you know, we'd pick two captains and everybody else would stand there. The captain would say, I'll have him. Next one would say, this one, this one, this one. And there's about three left. I was one of those three that was left. You know what they'd say? They'd say, you can have them. You know, I suspect Jesus would have been left in the three at the end. Nothing attractive physically. But you see, that is not what godliness is about. That is what the superficial world in which we live is about, of course. Do you know how much money we spend on cosmetics? I don't know either, but it's a lot. Face paint? Try and improve a little bit? Well, that's okay. Some of us may need that. But that is not a value of any significance outside of your own sense of well-being. Nobody else is as impressed with us as we'd like them to be. But nobody else thinks twice about how we look. It's just we who want to look in the mirror and say, yeah, looking good today. But the virtues that made Jesus who he was his kindness, his gentleness, the fact he would sit and talk with a woman nobody else would be seen with in the daylight. The fact that he would cross the road when a leper rang his bell, saying, anybody come close, and everybody would cross to avoid him, and Jesus would cross the road to greet him and touch him. Do you ever notice Jesus touched lepers always? It says he touched him. And it speaks about him dealing with lepers. Nobody touched lepers. That's the qualities that exhibited the presence of his Father and the character of God. But then if his personal appearance and his personal environment was tough, a root in a dry ground, and his physical appearance was that he had no beauty, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him, his social interactions are spoken about in verse 3. He was despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. There are some very harsh words in that verse. He was despised. That occurs twice, that word, despised. He was rejected by men. He was a man of sorrows. Think about that. That was his reputation. A man of sorrows. Not he'd been sorry and felt sadness on an occasion. It suggests an enduring sense of sorrow. Like one from whom men hide their faces, other people were embarrassed by him, would be the implication of that. He was despised. That's the second time that's there in the text. And we did not value him. We esteemed him not. What does all this mean? It means that socially, he's still on the outside. People did not embrace him, not encompass him. In fact, it sounds as though he was bullied. We know he was bullied as a man. And this verse leads into the description of his crucifixion, but it's a bridge from the life he was living generally to that, and the life he lived generally is what was characterized here as despised, rejected, a man of sorrows, not esteemed. What is the point of exploring this with you this morning? What is the message I want to leave you with? It is this, that as the perfect man, which the Lord Jesus Christ was, and therefore a model of what human perfection is, as God was working under the surface, molding and stretching and hurting, there was pain, suffering. So that although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. So we too must recognize that some of these situations in our lives that we would, if we could, eliminate and expel, and if we could rewrite the script, we would take it out, are actually part of God's toolkit in making us godly. Because you see, if Jesus learned obedience, although he was a son, it has to be learned. How do we learn it? Through these tough, difficult circumstances that drive us back to that obedience and dependence. You cannot separate those two. As we seek to obey, we realize our need to depend on God, for in and of ourselves we can do nothing. And what is true of Jesus is true for us in the molding and building and circumstances of our lives. That God is bringing about something which will express itself in fruit one day, but under the surface, the process can be difficult and painful. And maybe some of us here this morning are like a root in a dry ground. That would be a good description of our experience. We're in an environment where things around us would do everything they could to strangle the life. Maybe in your marriage, you don't share a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe your wife is not a believer and is mocking you even for being here this morning. Maybe your husband is not a believer. And in your marriage, you feel in a dry ground as far as your spiritual life and sustenance is concerned. Maybe your parents are hostile to the fact that you are a Christian. Maybe your children have turned their backs and are hostile to the gospel, and you feel your environment there is like a root in a dry ground. Maybe nobody notices you, and you feel insignificant, and there's nothing that causes people to be drawn to you, you feel, as it said of Jesus. And that loneliness, maybe that is the very mechanism by which God is doing something in your life and molding and building something. Maybe in your work or social environment, everything around you is trying to starve the life, spiritual life. Maybe you live with health issues and disabilities, and we all have our disabilities, but some are just more obvious than others. And maybe those disabilities, you say, if only that one thing could be changed in my life, man, I'd be such a different person. What if that one thing is the way God is making you like his son? We're not the first to walk this road. Jesus walked it, but then most of the human race has walked it too. He learned obedience from what he suffered. No fast track. He learned it and was molded by it. You know, there is a dangerous version of Christianity that does not accept suffering. It rejects it. It even mocks it. But you know, although I understand why people might start at that position, because the end result is the full perfection of the people of God one day, in every respect. But that is such a dangerous understanding of the Christian gospel, because these very things that we are asking God to get rid of, take it away, remove it, are often the very things that are his instruments for molding us. Remember going some years ago with a friend of mine who was older than me, generation older than me, but he was a friend, and we went to hear a preacher who was quite well known. He was a good preacher in England, and at the end of that service, we were talking about his message, and my friend said, you know, that was a good message, but if he were to suffer, it would be a great message. I thought that's a bit cruel. But that man did go through suffering. His wife went into a very deep depression. She became suicidal. She actually attempted suicide. And I got to know that man. And his sermons didn't necessarily change, but his ministry did. There was a quality to it that could only come from a man who'd experienced suffering. For many of us, those things are not on the surface. They're part of the submerged roots, the submerged part of the iceberg. But they're the means by which God molds and makes us. We don't reject or mock suffering, we embrace it. Romans 5, verse 3, I've read this verse several times here to you. Paul says, we also rejoice in our sufferings, which sounds masochistic, doesn't it? Why does he say that? We rejoice in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces, and I've underlined those two words in my Bible, suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. We don't turn our back on our sufferings. We actually embrace them. We rejoice in them. Why? Because we know suffering produces. It's a dynamic force in our lives. If it drives us back to a greater dependence on God and a greater depth of our knowledge of God, which again and again it often does. Man went into a sculptor's room, and there was a piece of marble. Big piece of marble there on the floor. And this man said to the sculptor, what are you going to do with that piece of marble? He said, I'm going to make a horse out of it. He said, how in the world are you going to make a horse out of that? He said, I'll knock off everything. It doesn't look like a horse. How's God going to make you like Jesus? He's going to knock off everything. It doesn't look like Jesus. And that can be a painful process. But it's a very wonderful process. Because that is where we find our deepest sense of satisfaction, our deepest sense of significance, our deepest sense of being loved, when we're driven back to a greater dependence upon God. You know, someone said to me during this last week, God doesn't answer my prayers. And they told me what they'd been praying for and for how long they had been praying, which is a number of years. And I said, what you mean is God is not giving me what I want when I want it. But have you ever considered that one of the best answers to prayer God may give you is to say no, or to say wait, or be patient, or there's something better going on here. The very thing you're asking God to fix might be his chisel that is molding you. You see, I'm calling this the Jesus you never noticed. Because not only did he not take the fast lane and the easy lane, but he pioneered the lane for every believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. He takes us down this road. Why? Because he has an ambition for you, an ambition for me, which is that he makes us like himself. And he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. That doesn't mean there was imperfection beforehand, But once sharpened and equipped and made as a man what the Father wanted him to be, then he became the author of salvation. That's why he didn't begin his ministry until he was 30. We'll talk about this next time. We're going to talk next time about the fact at the age of 30, the Father said at his baptism, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." And that raised the question, what was he pleased about? Was he pleased about his preaching? No, he hadn't preached anything. Pleased about his miracles? No, he hadn't done any miracles. Pleased about the influence he was having in Nazareth? No, nobody in Nazareth liked him. They rejected him. Pleased that you've let me for 30 years teach you obedience by the things that you suffer. Now you're ready. That's a lifelong process for us. And I want to encourage you not to get discouraged by your environment, not to get discouraged by the things that are going wrong. Of course, humanly we do, but to be able to look beyond them and say, "Lord Jesus, thank you that you are working out something better and deeper and richer than what I would like. So I'm going to trust you." And if it was good enough for Jesus, it is good for you and it's good for me. Let's pray together. Our Father, we come before you this morning as men and women and young people who are fully aware of all the things in our lives that we struggle with. Things that pull us down, things which discourage us, things that cause us to suffer, things that provoke cries, loud cries and tears. Lord, I pray that we will be people who have not only invited you to live within us, to cleanse us of our sin, to be our Savior and our Lord, but we'll be those who trust you. You're not making us all the same. You're making us uniquely that we might be an exhibition of your character and presence in the circumstance in which you've placed us. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that we will look to you and trust you. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price. This is my beloved Son. Do you see Jesus as a spotless figure in a long white robe? Think again. On earth, Jesus was every bit as human as you are, with the same struggles you face. He was lonely, in anguish. Like you, he was tempted. He was criticized. His life was not easy, and neither is yours. This 8-part series, The Jesus You Never Noticed, shows how the life of Jesus is a model for living your life. This series is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home. Give to a friend.
That's King James.
Or plan a group Bible study. Write to Living Truth to order by mail. Or call Canada +1 416 222 3341, extension 113. Or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca. Discover the real Jesus, the Jesus you never noticed.
Bill and Mary Snuey are faithful viewers of Living Truth. Last fall, a special edition on building life centers in Malawi caught their attention.
It's very important for the orphans and vulnerable children. Most of the children in community are vulnerable. But the center is really critical because otherwise the children just wander about and they get abused.
We as Christians are responsible for those conditions, responsible to look after them, to help them out, come alongside of them.
The Snuys are both from Holland and were married in Canada in 1956. Together, they built several businesses, a service station, and later a greenhouse. Now retirees, they live modestly off their hard-earned savings. It hasn't always been easy for the Snuys. They lost a young son, David, and a car crash left Mary with some health challenges. But through all that life has brought them, they have always had a strong faith and a passion for missions.
And that's why today we're asking you to call in and give a gift of hope for a girl like Chakutera.
We have been looking for things to help out. This idea of this center being a multiple use and having a hub of, what shall I say, where they can help people, is that really, I said to Mary, we should look into that. And I said, how would you think of sponsoring one of those? And she said, that's fine.
I don't come to you lightly with this request. I believe we can all participate in giving.
We have always been saving. Mary looks for if it is 2 for 50 cents or 1 for 26, you know. She will do that, but on the other hand, I don't give much value to money, really. I could depart from it. I like to see it being used well, because
well,
that's
we
where
had,
this
we had for years we had to struggle to make ends meet, and
yeah. Mm-hmm.
It gets embedded into you, you know. We figure, well, we're still alive, we like to see what it does.
Yeah.
Why wait till we're gone? And you know, now we see that it's going to be done and the benefit of it, and while we're still alive.
The Snuys like to get involved in projects they support. Bill has constructed a detailed model of the very life center they are helping to build right in his own living room. He can just imagine the children using the facility.
When we were in Africa too, then we went to an orphanage. And, you know, I remember the clinging of those kids.
I do feel that a life center like that must do a lot to those kind of children.
You see, this is that Malawi right here, the long way, and they have a lake here. When you're younger, you plan always for the future. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. In the flower business, we had that, and. When you come to a certain age, you measure that with an end, an ending. So you said, we came with nothing. So all I can pray about that this material input, it's bricks and stones, right? But that it will have an effect and bring glory to God by the people, you know, giving their lives to Christ, right? And that's part of this, the spin-off. We are so blessed. That's really where it is. That we feel we have to share.
All our praises and all our worship and all our praises. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him.